Thank you, Katie. Now we'll begin the forum for the Roselle School District 12 Board. Tonight we'll meet candidates Cassie Casarosi, Linda Galanti, and writing candidate Amy Magnus. Could you please take the stage? Candidates Victoria Tiberi and Cheryl Levine were unable to attend the forum this evening. So welcome, candidates, and thank you for joining us. So let's begin with opening statements. Candidate Galanti, you have 2 minutes for your opening statement.
Is that?
Yes.
Okay, thank you so much to all of you for being here. My name is Lydia Galanti, and so excited to be here. Thank you to the League of Women Voters for all of the time that you put into this. I have lived here in Roselle for over 20 years. In the past 11 of those years, I've worked in childcare. So I feel like I have unique insight into the lives of school-aged children. I decided to pursue candidacy to make certain that all of the children in our community are equipped with the knowledge they need to become kind and productive adults. As someone with a kindergartner in District 12 and someone who's very interested in local government, I feel that the Board of Education is the place for me to be. I already attend the board meetings anyway, so why not let me be there as your community representative? I volunteer my time with the Roselle Public Library Foundation, where I currently serve as treasurer. I also volunteer with Green Roselle, and I hope to leave our town cleaner and healthier for the next generation. I bring group problem-solving skills to the table from my time on Roselle's Zoning Board of Appeals, which on Monday was recently combined into the Planning and Zoning Commission. I have experience listening to the community's desires and beliefs before issuing a public opinion. I want to utilize these connections within Roselle to collaborate with groups and businesses. This will further the education of District 12 children and ensure that the entire community is invested in student success. My passion for education and local government make it so that I am fully ready to tackle all of the joys and challenges that District 12 may face in the coming years. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Casarosi, your 2 minute opening statement.
Thank you. My name is Casey Casarosi. So let's see, I've been kind of entrenched in public education in Illinois since I was born. Both my parents were teachers, all of their friends were teachers, all my friends were teachers' children, and it was like a community. It was awesome. We'd have monthly potlucks, and that's how I grew up. My stepmom now, my father remarried in 2016, is a retired professor from Southern Illinois University. When I was 14, I went to the Illinois Math and Science Academy. That's a school out of Aurora for gifted students that's a residential high school. And the reason I think that's interesting or helpful in an educational oversight role is because they have a lot of experimental curriculum that they work with the students. So I have firsthand knowledge of being in the middle of different types of learning models. I still serve on that admissions committee every year. I have a bachelor's degree in K through 12 teaching with a focus in music. I have a master's degree in journalism and I'm a member of Mensa. After I graduated and taught for a few years, I traveled a lot and I worked in the private sector. And that's really useful from an operational perspective and project management whenever I need to find a practical solution to a problem. I'm invested in T12 because my daughter's in second grade and I'd like her to have a solid educational background and positive school experience. My platform's all about empowerment. I want to empower students, staff, community, and our district. And I thank you very much.
Thank you. I remind you to hold your applause until we're through with the forum. Thank you. Candidate Magnus, your 2 minute opening statement.
Thank you, Roberta, and the League of Women Voters for inviting us here tonight. Thank you to everyone who is present tonight. I am Amy Magnus, and I am running as a write-in candidate for re-election to the Roselle School Board of Education. I was appointed to the board in 2021 and have been proud to serve for the last year and a half, supporting our schools out of the pandemic and continuing to work on accomplishing the goals of our District 12 strategic agenda. My husband and I have lived in Roselle for 10 years, and we have three children. My oldest is actually a D12 graduate currently at Lake Park. I have an 8th grader at Roselle Middle School who is about to graduate, and I have a 5th grader at Spring Hill School about to transition to RMS like her brothers before her. I am a former early childhood educator and director. I earned a degree in Family Consumer Sciences with an emphasis in child development from Northern Illinois University. I worked in the field of early childhood education for over 10 years before stepping back from my career to focus on my family. However, I've always dedicated myself to working with families and children. So I currently work as an administrative assistant for the Faith Formation Program at St. Walter's right here in Roselle. As a current board member, hoping to maintain my seat as a write-in candidate, I believe my education and my experience as a professional and as a longtime District 12 parent has brought added value to our district and has made me an asset to the current board. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We'll now proceed with the questions. Candidate Pezzarossi, this will begin with you.
Okay.
How has your background, skills, and experience prepared you to be an effective member of the district school board?
Thank you. I think one thing about my background that's helpful that I wasn't able to share in the introduction time limit is that my hometown is nothing like Roselle. It's very rural and rather impoverished, so I think the poverty rate in Roselle for school children is about 2%. My hometown was 47% last I checked, so when I grew up in that school system, I really kind of have a firsthand knowledge of what it's like to grow up in a system that has very little money, is not privileged, has a lot of challenges and barriers, and so I think that's helpful whenever we think about how we can help all of our students. Another aspect of my background that I think is helpful is that I did a lot of traveling after I was done with college, and being able to witness and experience what it's like to be out of your own skin in another country, not being able to speak the language in a new culture, gives a person a really good sense for what it means to be in a diverse area and how to respect different viewpoints and cultures.
Thank you. Candidate Magnus, how has your background, skills, and experiences prepared you to be an effective member of the district school
board? Well, as I mentioned in my opening statement, my degree is in child development, and I spent a good portion of my time before having my family working in early childhood. I worked as an early childhood educator, and I was a director for over 10 years. And having that experience, I think, brings a unique perspective regarding children's development and their social emotional development especially, and how that relates to academic progress. Also, being a director, I'm very experienced working within a team, being collaborative, being a good listener. Those are all important qualities. And finally, I think just as being a parent in the district for a long time, also helps me be a very effective Board of Education member. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Galante, you have 1 minute to tell us how has your background, skills, and experiences prepared you to be an effective board member of the district?
Earlier I touched on my appointment to Roselle's Planning and Zoning Commission. With that, most recently, I was involved in a steering committee this winter that recommended comprehensive amendments to the Roselle Zoning Ordinance. These were adopted Monday as well. Through this, and as treasurer of the Library Foundation, I've worked with people of all ages, races, sexes, political affiliations, and socioeconomic backgrounds. I'm familiar with the Illinois Open Meetings Act and with Robert's Rules of Order, which are extremely pertinent in a board situation.
Thank you. The next question will begin with candidate Agnes. What are some of the major issues that you believe the school district is currently facing? How should the district address these issues?
Those are really good questions. I think right now, actually, I think our district is sitting in a really good spot. We came out of the pandemic ready to go back. We've continued to work on our strategic agenda through the pandemic. I think as we sit here today, some of the challenges will be that being fiscally responsible, many schools have been receiving ESSERS funding from the government to help support them through the pandemic. And as our inflation is going up and that money is taken back, it will be very important for us to be mindful of our spending, making sure that we keep students at the center of every decision made.
Thank you. Candidate Galante, what are some of the major issues that you believe the school district is currently facing, and how should the district address those issues?
I agree with Candidate Magnus that the district is not sitting on any huge issues right now. I think some of the things that I'm seeing just as a parent are issues with communication. Parents and community members do seem to be hesitant to reach out to District 12 when they have a question or a concern. I think that needs to change. I'd love to see parents voicing positive or negative opinions at board meetings and not just on social media. I also hope to see a change in the district website to make it more user-friendly, explaining day-to-day policy choices in our schools, delineating how and why certain curriculum is put into place. I see you. I see that the community members have concerns and ideas, and I really want to be there to help people understand how to advocate for their children and how to be involved with local government.
Thank you. Candidate Pezzarossi.
Thank you. I think the district is doing very well. I have 1 minute, so I'm going to skip right to what I would consider two of our biggest opportunities. The first one, I think, is community engagement. So these ladies touched on that. I have a couple of practical ideas that I'm really excited about running by the other school board members and the administration. I think we should think outside the box, lower our guard, and look at other districts for inspiration. So we have so many wonderful community members that are ready to be engaged if they feel welcome to speak. So I'd like to start with including parents back into school activities, using room parents to help teachers. I mean, being a teacher is really hard. I think it would really help take the load off their mind if they had a little backup. We could also partner with local organizations to offer after-school enrichment classes and mentorship programs, especially the local ones like music, art. We have wonderful local restaurants. I think the kids would have a blast with that kind of thing.
Thank you. The next question will begin with Candidate Galante. What is your opinion of the level of student achievement in this district? On what do you base your assessment?
So I'm going to just talk about the facts here, not really, this one's, I don't feel like it's really my opinion. So looking at District 12's report card from the state of Illinois, students in every grade level are testing above state averages in every subject. I think the District 12 staff is exceptional and these numbers prove it. I don't have visual aid tonight, as Katie talked about earlier, but go on the district's website and check out the slideshow from February's Board of Education meeting where they talk about the student achievement update. Just in math, over 90% of District 12 students are on track to reach typical growth by the end of the year. Of course, I think that the board should remain diligent in advancing the curriculum as necessary. And I also believe that we should continue to support research-based curricula, ensuring that students continue to meet and exceed standards in our district.
Thank you. Candidate Pezzarossi.
Yes, I agree. The district's doing very well academically. The metrics show that the students are doing a good job in terms of not just the students, the teachers and administrators, the whole system's doing a good job getting the students to really get back on track after the pandemic. There's a couple things that I think would be really great academic opportunities. For example, the writing curriculum. I
think could be a little more modern. I got that feedback from a teacher parent within the district. And then also to develop a plan for gifted or accelerated students. Some of the parents of students that might be a little bit ahead in their grade feel like their kids might be needing some more engagement, I guess, in their grade level. So having a plan to keep them engaged as they go through elementary and middle school and the high school, that's going to be important to make sure they stay on track.
Thank you. Candidate Mannix.
I agree with Lydia. If you were at the February board meeting, we were so excited to celebrate all of the student achievement we've made in this first half of the school year. 72% of our students are on track to meet their learning goal, and that's just in the first half of the year. Many of the goals in the strategic agenda were to address learning gaps between some of our student subgroups. And the data has shown that students that are an English language learner or special education are actually trending up and really achieving that gap. And so I think the district is doing a great job working with the curriculum staff and meeting their strategic goals.
Thank you. Candidate Pizzarossi, how do you feel the district handled its response to the pandemic over the recent years?
I think the district did the best among most of the districts in the state. I would have liked to seen a little more empowerment in general, I think in all the public school system, but I think overall all our district did very well. I like that they kept the students in person as long as they could. I think that they did a pretty good job at facilitating as much social, emotional learning and engagement as they could during the expectation of distance. So I was overall pretty pleased with it comparatively. I think my criticisms of the pandemic response were more big picture.
Candidate Magnus, how do you feel the district handled its response to the pandemic over the recent years?
I think that District 12 paved the way for a model for many other schools. We were only one of nine schools in the Chicagoland area to remain open and offer in-person learning for our students. And I think that was so critical. You can see from the data that we have very little learning loss through that time. As a parent, hearing some of my friends in other school districts struggle while their children remote learn the entire school year made me very, very grateful that I was in D12 and for the board members and the administration that worked so hard to provide in-person learning for students who wanted it.
Thank you. Candidate Galante, how do you feel the district handled its response to the pandemic over recent years?
Thank you. I think the district did a great job. I'm going to echo a little bit of what Amy said, but I would like to touch on the fact that in all five of the Lake Park High School feeder districts, District 12 had the least percentage of learning loss, which is huge. The Board of Education and the administration worked tirelessly to create a hybrid schedule so that people who felt more comfortable at home and were available to be home could be. And then the other people could be at school if they so chose. They kept kids and families safe and at school, which was amazing. If you have time, check it out. Our superintendent and then Board of Education president co-authored a paper in the Illinois Association of School Boards on why a pandemic response manual is critical. And I think it's amazing that we have those people working at our small school to show that if something like this ever happens again, we are ready. And oh my God, I hope it doesn't happen again.
Thank you. The next question will begin with Candidate Bennis. Do you consider the effects of social media and bullying as issues in our district? Why or why not?
That is a really good question. And I do think that social media plays an incredible part of children's self-esteem and how they treat each other. I would say that is one of the main student concerns for mental health. And as a parent myself, whenever there's an issue at school or one of my children is unhappy, it always stems back to something on Snapchat, something on a
Candidate Galante.
Would you mind repeating the question just so I can answer the whole thing?
No problem.
Thank you.
Do you consider the effects of social media and bullying as issues in our district? Why or why not? And you have 1 minute.
So if we're going to talk about social media and bullying, I think that unfortunately this is a national issue. We can, of course, see it in our district. I would encourage you to take a look at some of the adult groups that go on in Roselle and see maybe where some of this is stemming from. Yes, I think this is an issue. I think this is a national issue, and I would love to see it addressed even on a larger scale. Unfortunately, there's no one-stop shop to end bullying, and there's also no one-stop shop to end our cell phones, to end children having phones. So I think, like Candidate Magnus said, if we continue to teach SEL in all areas of the curriculum, I'm hoping the next generation gets better.
Candidate Pesaroso, the same question.
Can you say that one more time?
Sure. Do you consider the effects of social media and bullying as issues in our district? Why or why not?
Yeah, I think that Lydia is right in this regard. I think it is sort of going to be everywhere. And the reason I think for that is because I think of social media as an extension or another modality. I mean, I think of the telephone as a new technology back in the early 1900s. Social media is a new technology in the 2000s. So things that are kind of not right in regular life could also not be right on social media, but it could be quickly expanded or quickly amplified. I think what I'd like to see, and perhaps this is something that can be integrated through SEL or another way of handling it, is to just really encourage students and adults to role model well. That if there's something that isn't going well, just take a pause, take a deep breath, and talk about it in person. I've been trying to practice this myself, and I find it really does help to reach out directly.
Thank you. The next question is for Candidate Galante. How does the school board balance the need to provide a quality education with the need to respond to the local taxpayer who may or may not have children enrolled in the district? I'll read it one more time, it's a long question. How does the school board balance the need to provide a quality education with the need to respond to the local taxpayer who may or may not have children enrolled in the district?
This is a great question, and I think it affects a lot of people here tonight. I can see a lot of faces of people who are community members that do not have children in the district. I think one way that we can show them that we are doing this for them as well is by our budget. It's balanced, it's stable, and that shows that the community supports this public education. And by our test scores, it shows that District 12 is a desirable place to live.
Yeah, thank you. Candidate Pesaroso.
Yeah, so this is a really interesting question because I think there's a lot of value that can come from things that aren't related to money. And while I do think that we need to pay our staff well, I think there are a lot of things that are priceless. I don't think people become teachers for the money. I mean, I used to be one. I know it's really hard out there and it is a lot of work, but they really love the students. They're really invested in helping our generation become, you know, the best they can be. I think supporting teachers in all the ways that we can as a community, and not just in the classroom. It could also be, as I said, I'm looking forward to presenting some community engagement programs. So for example, if the community is ready to help and parents are ready to help support the kids and the teachers, that's something that's a free resource if we can make it happen. So I think that's one way we can make sure that we add value to the education, we can improve things, and just keep everything high quality.
Thank you. Candidate Magnus, how does the school board balance the need to provide a quality education with the need to respond to local taxpayers who may or may not have children enrolled in the district?
I think, as Candidate
question will begin with you, and you'll have 1 minute. What is the role of schools in teaching children about topics such as sex education, cyber safety, AIDS, and wellness?
Can you repeat those 4 sections?
What is the role of schools in teaching children about topics such as sex education, cyber safety, AIDS, and wellness?
Those are 4 very different topics, in my opinion, so I'm not sure I would group all those 4 together. I think sex education can be controversial, so with my platform I was sharing with you of empowerment, part of my perspective is the more local we can make decisions, the better off everyone will be. So for example, if one family feels like they want to do a certain kind of curriculum and everyone wants to opt out, I think that's important. So I always favor local control with sex ed. I would probably put AIDS into that category because it falls under STDs. Cybersecurity, is that the other one?
Mm-hmm.
And wellness. Wellness, I like to incorporate it into the physical education curriculum, so I think it's pretty fundamental. And cybersecurity, I would consider part of technology, so I also think it's fundamental.
Thank you. Candidate Magnus, what is the role of schools in teaching children about topics such as sex education, cyber safety, AIDS, and wellness?
Those are a lot of hot button issues right there in that question. I think it's important to view those topics under the umbrella of health and safety. I believe that presenting information that is grade level appropriate is very important. As Casey stated, I think it's also important that parents know what will be presented to their children, and they will have always the opportunity to opt out. I know there's some legislation that has come down that makes everyone a little bit nervous, so it will definitely be something to continue to keep an eye on and partner with parents in the best way to teach our children about all those important topics.
Thank you. Candidate Conte, the same question.
Thank you. I think a lot of great things have already been said. I just want to let everyone know that in the Illinois Senate, Senate has gone session sine and die, which means there's not a set date to reconvene about the sex education bill removing the district's opportunity to opt out. So currently our district has opted out of the national sex education curriculum. Some of that can be a little bit dangerous for those kids that are the most vulnerable in our community. We need to teach people safe. It prevents against sexual abuse if we are teaching children age-appropriate things that can help prevent against sex abuse. And what if someone opts out of that and they're the most vulnerable child and we didn't protect them? That would just be devastating. And I want to say that presenting medically accurate information affirms our culturally diverse community. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. It was for 1 minute. Next question will begin with Candidate Magnus. What role do you feel parents should play in today's school environment?
Well, parents are children's first teachers, so they have a very important role to play. I think our district has done a wonderful job incorporating opportunities for parents to be involved in their children's education. I do also know some of those opportunities have been discontinued because of the pandemic, and many families are looking to bring some of those back. So I look forward to, as we continue to move forward, providing more opportunities for parents to be involved through field trips, lunch with their children. I've had some parents ask me about the watchdog program again. I think there are lots of different ways that parents can be involved currently and that we can continue to look at offering in the future.
Thank you. Candidate Galante, your thoughts.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to touch back on all the pieces that I volunteer, and I want to utilize those connections to, again, bring in parents and community members into our
Thank you. Candidate Pesarosi, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think my answer to this question is parents should be involved as much as is structurally possible to be supportive and not annoying. And the reason I say that is because I do think teachers appreciate help whenever they're swamped, right? They have a full plate, kids are a handful, but I also know as a former teacher that every now and then you need a little space to make decisions. So I think that we should work with teachers to figure out what's actually supportive to them without being too far into the details that it makes it hard for them to teach their classes. But yeah, I agree. I think we should have a lot of different opportunities for the kids. I love the idea of parents getting involved with enrichment programs, extracurricular, community development. There's a lot of business owners in our district. I think it would be amazing to explore how that could be incorporated into different optional curriculum days and such.
Going on to the next question, Candidate Galanti, will begin with you. What are your thoughts about the district's school safety? Are there actions or policies you feel the district should address?
As far as physical safety of our students, I feel really great. There have been some recent additions to both schools to help, I guess, keep people out, for lack of a better term. This kind of, for me, goes along a little bit with the last question. A lot of parent involvement is not day-to-day board policy, that's more school policy, but a board policy that I would push for is background checks. If you're entering our school, we'll need to see background checks, and this is something that is precedented in lots of other districts surrounding us and all through Illinois and the country.
Thank you. Candidate Pesarosi.
Can you repeat both parts of that question?
What are your thoughts about our district's school safety? Are there actions or policies you feel the district should address?
I think they do a pretty good job with school safety. I think the best way to look at this, I've heard comments from some parents that there could be improved measures at, when your students are let out of the building. And so I don't know all the details, but I would like to look at some of the larger districts and see how that works, because it's kind of crazy, right? Have to let all the kids go, there's a lot of parents picking them up. You know, how do you match up all these parents with the right students and make sure everybody's safe? I don't have all the answers to that, but I think we should look at it in context of other districts and feeder districts and those sort of younger age districts, not just Lake Park. And I agree that background checks might be useful. I think whatever barriers are there to getting parents involved should be addressed. If we can handle COVID mitigations and still be in school, surely we can get parents in the building safely. So if that's background checks or any other kind of system, I'm all about developing a good system.
Thank you. Candidate Magnus, what are your thoughts about our district's school safety policy? Are there actions or policies you feel the district should address?
I agree with these ladies. I think our district has done a great job with the safety and security of our schools, and in fact, they have made some enhancements. Several years ago, all the classroom doors were equipped with a lock from the inside that is an extra barrier at school. There is, recently, at Roselle Middle School, they have a police officer that parks just to be a presence and be visible to the students and the community. I think that one of the issues about parents and involvement, it does stem from the need, do we need to background check them or not? So I do think that's one area that we can continue to look at and address.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this will be our last question. You can take a deep breath. And it's a two-part question, and I'd be happy to give you an extra 30 seconds to answer this question should it be needed. What issue stands on the balanced literacy versus structured literacy debate currently happening in public education? What do you believe our approach to literacy instruction should be in District 12? And I'll read it one more time. What is your stance on the balanced literacy versus structured literacy debate currently happening in public education? What do you believe our approach to literacy instruction should be in District 12? And we'll begin with Candidate Banks.
I'm sorry. It's actually Candidate
Mr. Rossi. I thought it might be.
I'm going to check before you spoke.
I'll be really honest. I haven't heard the term structured literacy, so I'm going to take my own interpretation of that. I had something I wanted to share as an idea, because I know that books are a very controversial issue in schools now, and I've been paying a lot of attention. So I'm not sure this is what the question is about, but I think this would be a really interesting topic to consider for the public. D12 has done a really good job at getting ahead of the curriculum controversy with the task force for SEL. I think we could get ahead of the book controversy by having a similar kind of process. So if there was a group of people that could get together, or perhaps it's another goal for the SEL committee, such that we could organize a written vision and mission for what we want our school library to accomplish, I think that would help the curating process to prevent a lot of controversy. Because what I noticed is people have different goals for their school libraries. Some people think it's supposed to be a place where everybody has something for them, and no matter what corner of the universe it comes from. And some people think it should only be core materials that everybody agrees on. And I think we have to decide which one it is, so that way whenever we go to pick materials, everyone understands that we met the vision and the mission and such for the community. So that's my proposal. I think we should get ahead of that controversy, and I think it would help keep everything cohesive for our community.
Thank you. Candidate Reyes, would you let me repeat the question? What is your stance on the balanced literacy versus structured literacy debate currently happening in public education? What do you believe our approach to literacy instruction should be in District 12? And you have 90 seconds. Thank you. Candidate Galante, would you like me to repeat the question?
Okay. Thank you so much. I'm going to be the one to say it. I'm not going to tiptoe around this. We are not banning books in D12. We cannot be doing that. As soon as children step into District 12 schools, they should be 100% loved for the person that they are. And they should be able to read books about themselves and see pictures of themselves and see who they are. Curating books is extremely dangerous, and frankly, it's impossible to do because our community is so diverse, and there's no way that everyone is going to be able to agree on this. I think it could be a parent's role to select what their children are reading based on their beliefs, and I love that. I think that's a great idea for people to do in their own homes. So that's what I think District 12's approach should be, is to make sure that there are things that children can read and see about themselves no matter who they are.
Thank you. Ladies, it's time for closing statements. We'll begin with Candidate Magnus, and you have 1 minute for your closing statement.
Thank you all for this time. share my thoughts and my qualifications, and mostly my interest in continuing my involvement on the Roselle District 12 Board of Education. I'm hopeful that our time together has allowed everyone to feel the commitment and passion I have for District 12 and for our Roselle community. I believe I bring an important perspective to our current board with my experience in education, in child development, and family sciences. And in my time on the Board of Education, I have demonstrated my ability to listen, ask questions, and continue to contribute to moving District 12 forward in a positive direction, keeping students at the core of all decisions while being a good steward of the district's finances and the taxpayers' money. With your support, I hope to maintain my seat on the Board of Education and ask that you write my name in on April 4th so I can continue to proudly serve our schools and community. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Galante, your 1 minute closing statement.
Thank you for everyone, to everyone that is here. I'm so glad you could spend this evening with us. Once again, thank you to Barb and to the League of Women Voters of Roselle for hosting this. Thank you, Lake Park, for having this space open. There were a lot of things that you probably wanted to ask about that you couldn't tonight based on time. Please reach out to me directly if you have any more questions. I encourage all of you to vote for the candidate or candidates that will usher our community into the future help our children grow and develop in an inclusive and loving environment. I'll close this with what my five-year-old screams around our house lately. Vote Lynn for your kid.
Thank you. Candidate Pesarosi, your 1 minute closing statement.
So thank you to the League for sponsoring this. I think I have a lot of experiences that could help serve our parents and our educators and get the community engaged. I want to help build a better sense of community. I want to increase parental involvement, improve staff engagement and retention. I want to start school and community mentorship programs in partnership with enrichment opportunities. So my platform is all about empowerment at every level. Empowerment for students, empowerment for staff, community, and empowerment for our district. I think we can empower each other and empower ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, please join me in thanking the candidates for being here tonight. Thank you so much.